Hello, and wishing everyone a very happy Sinhala and Tamil New Year. May all your dreams and wishes come true in this wonderful season. Here I am with a small New Year gift, the Marketing Management Audio Summary for Enterprise Operations subject. I'm Tharindu Amarasekara, the lecturer at Vista Business Academy. And this is yet another step in making you pass. So what is marketing? Marketing is about satisfying and keeping customers happy so that the customers will continue to buy from you. It's about understanding them and not just trying to sell them. It's about making a product that they want and not just trying to make some product which you think they will want. So marketing, by its definition, is about identifying and satisfying consumer needs and wants in a profitable manner. Now, with this regard, before companies were marketing oriented, they followed some other approaches. One is called product orientation, where they just made the product that they thought the people will want. The other one is called sales orientation, where they just try to sell any product to the customer. And the other one is called a production orientation, where the focus was on efficiency management. That means trying to keep the cost to the lowest. Now, marketing function will be affected by several factors. These are called environment. For example, internally, your fund availability or skills availability will have an impact on your environment, on your marketing ability. For example, if you take Samsung, when they make mobile phones, they need that skill, they need the funding available inside the company so that they can go ahead and make those phones. So that is internal environment. And on the other hand, when you say external environment, you might be looking at the immediate external environment that will include the customers and your suppliers. So if you take a company like Ferrari, what the customers are demanding will have an impact on their product. That is why now Ferrari, as more and more customers are demanding for hybrids, Ferrari launched a hybrid car. And also whether their suppliers like Nankang tires, whether they are able to supply to them or not the required tires for a hybrid car, will also have an impact on the ability of Ferrari to make a hybrid car. So that is what we call the market environment. That's one part of the external environment. We can call it the micro environment. Under the macro environment, we are looking at the pest factors, political issues. For example, if there is a government ruling against certain types of products, then they will not be able to provide that. For example, if you take Ranbaxy, the famous Indian medical company, Ranbaxy is having a huge issue in US, where you know they have been asked and they have been demanded to stop some of their products due to political concerns over their products, and it can also include legal concerns. And also economic, if the economy is doing well, then luxury brands like Armani, Versace, Gucci, Hermione Gildo, Zegna, all of them will do very well. And also the social, you know, with disposable incomes increasing in Sri Lanka, they say that companies like Softlogic, you know, through all their brands like Nike and here this Charles and Keith and various other brands, they have been doing 24% more in sales than last year. So that shows that along with the economic growth, that companies will do well. And social-wise, society-wise, you know, the demographics, the people. And if there's a more young population, then companies like Coca-Cola can sell more products. That is why they are investing in USA. The USA has a growing young population. And also we are looking at technology. Social media, mobile, with the growth of all these, companies have to evolve. That's why Chanel, which is a very famous luxury fashion brand, they are investing in mobile platforms where people can watch fashion videos online using the mobile phone, and also buy using the mobile phone as well. So we can see how the pest factors, the extreme external factors, will have an impact on the organization's marketing ability. Now, there's a very important element in marketing which we call the marketing mix. Marketing mix is all those variables using which we influence the customer mind and make them buy. For example, the product, the features, the branding, all that. If you take a Nike shoe, you know, the design, the logo, the colors used, the packaging, everything has an impact on our decision to buy it. then the place where you make it available. Nike, for example, will have their products in luxury and high-end shopping malls and not in some side-by shop. It's the place, the price. As we know, Nike doesn't come cheap, starting with more than 15,000 almost. So that shows the importance of the price, because the price conveys a message about your product as well. And also, you look at product, price, place, the promotion, very important. Now, under promotion, we are looking at how we communicate about this product. Will we use advertising? Will we use sponsorships? You know, Nike sponsors a lot of sporting events. Will we use social media and the web? You know, for example, Nike uses various online games, which allows basketball fans and other sporting fans to interact with the brand and use some of those products for their game characters while they play the game. So these are all different ways of promotion. Right now, advertising is very common. We also have this concept of product placement. We can see that certain products being used in some movies, right? For example, a lot of Lenovo products being used in the Transformers movie. Now, all these are ways of promotion, how we send the message about our product to the customers. Now, moving on in this, we also have come across what we call buyer behavior. Now, buyer behavior is a marketing theory using which we try to understand why people buy and what makes them buy our product. So first of all, we try to recognize the consumer buying process. They look for they understand that they have a problem. Next step, they will look for options. Let's say, for example, in your case, you understand that you need to buy a new watch, and then you start looking for what are the options available in Sri Lanka to buy watches, or what are the options available online to buy watches. You evaluate different sources. Let's say you'll evaluate between a Tag Heuer and a Rolex, and then you make the decision, okay, I'm going to go for the Tag Heuer. And then you later check, okay, am I happy with this decision? Is it giving me what I want? Is it giving me that look and feel? Is it giving me the recognition? You will check for these things. So that's the entire consumer buying process. Problem recognition, right? Search for information, identify options, evaluate and buy, and review whether it was the correct decision. Now, this will be affected. This entire process will of course be affected on factors such as your family. If you are a married person, you'll have more parties involved in the decision making, in the case of a TV or so. But if you are living alone, then when you are buying a TV, you have more freedom. And it also depends on whether this process is repeated often or not. For example, when it comes to buying a daily toffee, to eat, if you are buying the same brand again and again, there won't be much decision making. And it also depends on your social factors, such as your friends, your office colleagues, what they say. And it will also depend on your income situation. So there are many factors which will influence this entire consumer buying process. Now, if you always follow this approach, then we call it a rational or a cognitive approach. Because in the case of buying a product such as a car, you will always be following the whole process. But in the case of something like a toffee, a chocolate, a CD from your favorite artist, you might not do that. You might just buy it on a habit. For example, if Akon is your favorite artist, if he has released a new CD, you won't be checking for information. You will just buy that, isn't it? But looking back further, in the case of going on a holiday, now, when it comes to going on a holiday, you might consider your previous experiences. You might consider what you had come across before. And you might also look at what the others are saying online about it. That's why social media and the web is so important today. And you will look at all that, and then only you will make the decision, am I to go to the same place like before? Well, I had a good time there, but recently people are complaining, or should I try a new place where people are saying it's good? Now, that is what we call learned behavior theory, where people make the decision to buy or not based on the experiences of them as well as their friends. Now, So the concept of marketing moves one step further with the concept of strategic marketing planning. Now, strategic marketing planning is where the company comes up with a plan for marketing in line with the company objectives and strategy. For example, in the case of Apple first of all has to identify what are its corporate objectives, what profits do they want, what markets do they want to enter, and then they had to conduct for themselves a situational analysis, which we call a SWOT analysis. Now, a SWOT analysis will identify what are its strengths. In that case of Apple, it could be the branding. What are its weaknesses? Maybe lack of presence in certain developing markets. What are the opportunities? Countries like China opening up will be an opportunity. And what are the threats? It could be the rise of low-cost brands and copycat brands like the ones in Taiwan and the ones in China and the Korean ones. Now, they will study all this analysis, and then, having done that, so you first study your corporate objectives, the profits they want and the market expansion they want. They convert it into a marketing set of objectives, which will include the concerns from the marketing department. Let's say, for example, if the top management says achieve 100 million profits more, in terms of marketing department, you are looking at more products. So maybe new products, maybe you are looking at selling more products from the existing products to the same markets. You're also looking at entering new markets. You're also looking at increasing the number of customers. You're also looking at enhancing the customer satisfaction levels. So all these will be coming under the concept of marketing objectives. So Apple will first have to set the corporate objectives, then it will have to set the marketing objectives, then it will understand its current situation as it stands now, then it has to do the heart of the marketing strategy, which we call RSTP, research, segmentation, targeting and positioning. Research is where Apple will have to study the market in detail. What are the different consumer groups? What do they want? What are their needs? That is research. So it will involve, you know, doing interviews, doing questionnaires, maybe online surveys, observing some consumers and how they behave inside the Apple shops. All that comes under research. Then comes segmentation. Having studied the market, break it into groups, young and old, male, female. I mean, we see that nowadays there are products like the pink iPod. Why? It's to target and provide a phone or a music player for those female growing consumer market. So segment the market, because male and female needs from iPod will be different. So try to give different products for those different segments. Also, the next step will be positioning. So positioning is about, next step will be targeting. So once you have segmented the market, the company can decide, okay, we will target these segments out of all the existing segments. For example, in the case of Ferrari, they divide the market, they segment the market for rich and poor, and they decide to high income and low income, and they decide to target the high income. And we have to make sure that when you're targeting a market, ideally there should not be a similar competitor of the same size, and it should also be a case where that particular market segment has a need that is not fulfilled and it has a potential to grow. And once you have targeted the market, the company's next step is positioning. Within that targeted segment, how will we be different? For example, Armani Hotels targets the high income holders, and within them they create a different name for themselves on the basis of design. You know, everything from the hotel interior to the hotel beds and to the wallpapers which are there on the walls, from the flower decorations, everything will show a differentiation in terms of design internally. So all these comes under positioning. Once this is done, then as discussed before, the marketing mix must be developed depending on how the company plans to position itself. The products have to be created, and you have to decide on the features of the product, the pricing. Now, in the case of Armani Hotels, because it's high quality will have to focus on premium pricing, while another brand like a low cost airline will focus on more of a low budget pricing. Promotions have to focus on the aspects which you try to push in on. A company like Four Seasons Hotels will always focus on the high quality and the unique experience they get. So these come under the concept of pricing mix, under the promotion mix. Under the pricing mix for a company like Four Seasons Hotels, they'll have to do premium pricing. But on the other hand, if a company is trying to enter a market, say for example Etisalat or Airtel, when they entered Sri Lanka, they followed what we call the discounted pricing system, which we call penetration pricing, reducing prices to enter the market. But on the other hand, Dialog in response did predatory pricing, as we know. They cut back the prices to reduce the chances of Airtel gaining market share. So there are different options available. Under place mix, if it's a mass market product like a basic chocolate, a middle income market chocolate for 50-60 rupees or 70-80 rupees or 100 rupees, then they should have look at having it available in all the mom and pop shops as well throughout the country, all little retail shops. But if you take a luxury chocolate brand or a very high-end Swiss chocolate brand, their place mix should focus on having a few retailers, ideally in the city centers, and you know, where high net worth individuals or high income holders are most likely to do the shopping, because we are looking at chocolate bars which are worth 1,000 rupees upwards. So depending on what your positioning is, depending on what your target market is, the company has to come up with a proper marketing mix. The product mix, 1P, price mix, another P, place mix, another P, and the promotion mix, another P. Now, under promotions, we can't ignore the concept of social media. And from my experience, I know that it's a growing area. So the company must look at how it can use Facebook, Twitter, blogs, and be a friend of the customer. Not just try to sell a product, but be a friend. Communicate like a friend. Provide value like a friend. Add value and communicate things and interact with the customer like a friend. Give a chance for the customer to interact with the brand and be a friend of the brand. That is the key goal of social media. Now, we also have e-business, where business is done online, where customers are allowed to buy things online. Of course, this is growing. We can see that companies like Toyota, Lexus are in fact giving a chance for the companies like Toyota, Lexus are giving a chance for customers to buy their vehicle odd and buy their Lexus online. So it's a growing area. But of course, hacker threats and problems such as some people not being comfortable with the English language and fears of buying things online, even small $10, $1, $5 items from eBay due to fear of credit card risk. And also there'll be a high initial cost which will get smoothened out over a time period due to reduction of other expenses. For example, if you have an e-business outlet, you need not always be having a main shop. So these things have to be looked at as well. Also, when it comes to service marketing, companies use another three additional mixes, which we call the people mix, have present people who will deliver a friendly service. Process mix, have a process where it's clear and easy and quick for the customer to get the service and check out. And also the concept of we looked at the people mix, we looked at the process mix, and also with regard to services, we have physical evidence. Physical evidence is the next mix, where we say although a service is intangible, it's not easy to measure. Consumers measure the quality of the service. It depends on the consumer's mood, because and it is subjective. Although we say all this, we can give some tangible elements which will make the service tangible. Now, it can be a small movie, let's say after a movie you will have the customer to buy a t-shirt with that movie printed, or it can be for example a nicely printed concert ticket for Yanni, where people can get the signature of Yanni and then they can have it as a souvenir. It can be anything. For example, this one time when I was having my vacation in Thailand, in the Phuket Islands, Once I returned from a boat trip, a day trip to a nearby bay, they gave me a picture of myself before I went on that trip, and with all the boats in the nice dock area, and they gave that to me with some nice decorations of seashells and all. So that, as I speak now, is in front of me, and whenever I see that, I remember that service, although that service is easily about 2 years ago. So this is the power of physical evidence. So in the case of a hospital, it can be having the interior nicely done to give a nice idea about it. It can be getting people to comment with on the website what they feel and how they were treated during the service. All these come under the concept of physical evidence. Now, moving on, when we are doing marketing, we must be socially responsible. We must never cheat our customers. We must always tell them the truth. That's why Lifebuoy says they are 99% germ-free. The company must never participate in anything bad for the environment. You must try to do green marketing, where it's about marketing being done in a way where the environment is not damaged. And also under marketing, the company must be responsible, where it should not target children. There are so many ads that are pulled out due to children being targeted. Now that is responsibility in marketing. And also, under marketing, the company must, not only companies, even not-profit organizations, NGOs, governments can use marketing. An NGO like Save the Children can use marketing to gain new fans and gain new volunteers, to obtain donations, and to also to reach out to people and say, look, we are there to help you. If you have a problem, tell us. So, and in the case of an NGO or a not-for-profit or a charity, there is a lot of stakeholders involved, unlike in the case of a company. For example, in the case of a charity, the government, the donor, the ones who are receiving the benefits, and various other authorities, the public, everyone is having their eyes focused. What is this charity or NGO doing with the money they have raised? That might not be the case for a company. You know, people just don't care what companies do with the money they have raised. But for NGO, yes, they will be concerned. So this has to be factored in, that not-for-profits like NGOs and charities have a lot more stakeholders to handle than a normal organization. And if you take a public sector, like a public department, a government department, their main concern from marketing will be the research. They'll want to do research, identify the needs of the public, health problems, social problems, and come up with social marketing campaigns. Now, a social marketing campaign is basically a campaign done to address a social problem. For example, in Sri Lanka, realizing the level of domestic violence rising, the government did some campaigns where they encouraged to abstain from domestic violence, and they encouraged people to stand up against domestic violence. So these come under the concept of social marketing. So all in all, in our discussion, in our summary, we have looked at most of the key areas of marketing. I hope you find this audio clip to be useful. Do take a look at it, go through it in detail. Of course, the main note, there'll be more areas which I want you to look at. For example, areas like BCG metrics, product life cycle, I want you to go through them in detail. Even for the other areas of marketing, so study the main note, go through the short note, use this summary as a guide on most of the key areas which you need to be thorough with. And I wish you all the best, and expect the information systems summary soon.